Yeah, let's hear another.
All right. Funny thing is I started out in law enforcement, and so did Ed. All right. And we found that as we've gone through our safety lives, we find that a lot of people started out in law enforcement and have gone into the safety side. It is kind of funny that you started out that way. I've been in the field for a long time, over 20 years. I love it. I enjoy it. I love the people I work with. I think to be a safety leader, you need to care about the people that you work with. When you're a leader, it's not all about you. What the leader learns is the only way to be a leader is to serve.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. That's what I've learned over the years. And because of that, I find that it's, you know, in some ways I'm an informal leader and a formal one. It depends on what's going on. And just like Colonel Walker here today, he is a very formal leader, but he's also a very informal leader when it's a crowd that he knows that he still needs in his family. And he said something yesterday. He said that their name, you weren't sure about that. I think it's both ways. I think some people are just born with that quality to lead. But some leaders are self-made and they have taught themselves. Because a leader is different than a manager. What's a manager? What's a manager?
They organize resources.
Yes.
Managing
resources. They take care of the program.
Yeah.
They're making sure that there's people to do the job, equipment to do the job, and
management is one section, leadership is another.
Leadership is people that will follow. People are not have to be a manager to be a leader.
Yeah.
All right. So that's where we're important. So what I'm going to talk about is qualities that a leader must have. Because I must have a union representation for such a great leader. I'm looking at him and I'm going, he's a little sick person here. So you always just want to lead by example. And a safety culture is, anyone in that whole place would have come up to me, and I had that happen to me at a Lockheed Martin in California. I just walked in, I was doing an interview. But I was doing an interview, and I came in, and one of the gentlemen came up and was like, you know, I think you're lost. I said, what's and he said, you should have came in here without safety glasses. She said, this is just a work booth. And I thought, oh, this is a good place to work. All right, that's a good place to work. Find your people aren't doing that as safety leaders. Start educating. You know, sometimes, and I'm not saying, sometimes you just don't want to say anything. But in the workplace, it is.
Yeah.
Okay? And that's what you've got to stress to. It is different. All right? And I always talk about the difference between values, and I'm sure you guys have heard this. I used to do everyday safety all the time. I've done total safety culture with Scott Keller. I've done the BST, everyday safety process. I've done Dave Thomas, Scott. All right? They're all wonderful. Just take one. Don't combine them. I had five companies that were coming together to integrate a government facility, and one group wanted Stop DuPont, one wanted BST. Oh my gosh. Wasn't that a mess? Anyway, that doesn't work, which I tried to explain to them. That would not work. But if you take one, and you let the workers and the senior managers and middle managers take it and adopt it and take it internally as a value, it works. And it doesn't go away when the company goes away. That's an interesting factor. It doesn't go away when a company goes away. We did mind control, safety, and health, and Ed and I and Doug all did that. When the companies change, you still have your groups and supervisors and workers. How many people do work packages for working members? You do. You look for facilities you work
with? University of California.
Okay. And you have work packages where you're providing maintenance programs, things of that nature.
Research.
Research labs. Yeah, we got labs. We got laboratory work. And does it help? It is very critical. Anyone else? And facility?
Construction sites.
Oh, yeah. Job hazard analysis, planning the work, identifying the hazards, implementing controls. All right. And so let me give you a little background on that. Integrated safety management, recognized by the field and construction, actually, because I work in construction. Is planning the work. You can be invisible and be out there with the workers and help plan the work. Actually, I have a tabletop to talk about what the identify what the scope of the work is, identify what the hazards are, and then put the controls in place and the job hazard analysis. All right? And then once you put that in writing, document, and you set together a work package that tells you step by step, or in general instructions for your staff of what to do, then you can go ahead and do the work, right? Get their feedback, obtain feedback. And then if something, is it a living document out on the construction site? For your work packages? Consider it a living document.
Could you use JAJ, global, overall, then we do what we call safety task assignments, so each task that we're doing, guys, sit down and have a little meeting to talk about the hazard associated with the panel, what resources they have to have to effectively get the job done safely.
Right. And then they go do the work.
So it's a living document attached to that.
Right, the task. Because we have a pre-job report, it's a checklist for them, and they'll just check what hazards are there. But then they make themselves familiar with it, probably they will do you guys. They make themselves familiar with it, so when they go do the work, they know what the controls are. Right?
Big picture.
The big picture. All right.
part of that process. You want to come in and say something to them that they have, they might want to ask you a question about, and are you involved in that? Are you a safety manager for safety?
Not directly involved, okay.
Huh?
Not directly involved, so.
All right, but do you do safety there at the construction site, or does everybody?
Everybody involved, everybody's engaged.
On the city side, we get involved with the contractors for the most part. They bring in contractors to see what kind of work they're going to do.
Right.
And we listen to the process that was in place for the job, so we can identify what needs to be put in place from a safety perspective. That will make the contractor right now, they have to take.
Can I see that does help? Because you're out there. You're actually listening to what the scope of work is and what needs to be there. That's why we like being visible. They need to know that they can turn to you, look at you, and know that you're there to help them. All right? So set the precedence. And of course, once again, we have guidelines, health and safety regulations in place. Now we've got to implement them. They got to follow them. And they're looking for the safety leaders in formal and informal. And they're watching. They're seeing, are you following with the rules and regulations? And if they are not, then if you are not, they're going to go cut. Must not apply to us. It's real quick. Okay? So, we follow the established guidelines. And if we see an established guideline that is wrong, actually, have you ever had a rule that was so not right? Because what it did was put people at risk, like maybe too much paperwork. Our electrical safety is only 93 pages long, so it's here. But really, and truly, that's when people take shortcuts. So that's wrong. Now, as a safety leader, what are we supposed to do? Yeah,
what's that upper management that it needs to be changed?
We'll start with actually the SME. Because really, start with the SME, and then you get the buy-in. If you get the SME agreement to, and if you have a tracking and trimming of accidents or shortcuts that are, or near misses that are occurring, you've got facts. I believe in facts. Well, I believe in facts. Facts are important. Get the facts. If there's been a whole lot of incidents on electrical stuff, if we're seeing a lot of cars right now because our police can't buy electrical, only 9 inches long. Bring the facts up to the SMEs. If they can see the tracking and training, things will change. May take a while, but they will change. If you're an advocate and you believe in it and you know it, go for it. Okay? It does change. I had a person call me up 5 years after I'd done an accident investigation, I'd done corrective actions, I beat it to the bone, tried to get everything done. And I just kept punching it. 5 years later, somebody called and said, oh, you know, we wanted to let you know. We did all the little shred on the stairs, and we did the handrails, right? And then that means that, you know, just now, I'm thinking, it only took 5 years. But it just got to do that. It does happen. Hopefully, it doesn't take that long. But it, just keep that. But you can do it. Okay, be proactive. If you see something, Oh, that was interesting in that presentation we had on the ad machine. You see something, say something. Same thing with safety. You see something, say something. Do something. Put it in writing too. Why should put it in writing? We have a system, we have a system where we have bright ideas. And anybody, any of our workers, I'll touch on it, any of our workers can go, he's just upset, he's just mad. Anybody with bright ideas, anyone can put a bright idea in, all right, and it's online. And it goes into our CA web issue, which is an issue, which is, you know, where you put your safety concerns. And the reason they started putting it into the bright idea, and I liked it, I liked that idea. Actually, it was a worker that thought of that, I thought that was pretty cool. The reason they put it into the bright idea, into the CA web, is the manager needs to respond to it. They need to say, is that reasonable? Can we do something like that? So, I think that's kind of cool, because at least there's an action that has to be accomplished. One, we can. Two, we can't. If we can, how can we go do it? And some of it's just as easy as this, as just saying, hey, I got a bright idea, and it was implemented. How simple is that? That's putting something in place that anybody can go online and put it in. Now, some of it, I got to admit, you know, you get some strange thought processes out there, but you have to respond.
Amen to that.
And I don't think that's a bad thing. All right. What have you done on your proactive approaches? What things have you put in place?
I say, with the city of San Antonio, what we've done, no one's chasing after the fact, accidents, things like that. What we've done was we put a proactive program in place where our facility inspections, where we're doing facility inspections on a more frequent basis. So we're going out making sure that things are done. When we do that, we're pulling our work run to see where our accidents are happening at. And we're putting those locations at the top of the list, so we go out and identify those areas that may be causing those injuries. And that's number one. Number two, we do worksite observations. Where we're going out, being present, we're observing the employees, looking at their tools, their equipment, and how they're functioning in their job. And we turn it around and communicate that information back to management. We can work with them to make sure they got the right tools, equipment, and training. Then we got what we call vehicle safety tests. We go out in the morning while our fleets are going out. Every one out of every five vehicles, we go in and check them real quick, check the tires, look and see if their safety devices are working properly, their seatbelt, and they got the right credentials on them, and then we just let them go. So those are proactive approaches we took to kind of help them get into a mind frame about what they're ready to do. And we're communicating with management on the equipment and things and issues that we see, and we can correct those things.
That is very proactive.
Yes.
At the plant in Alaska that I work at, we have created a safety challenge. And we give out $200 gift cards. And it's for going above and beyond your job for safety. So no, you don't get it just for doing everything that you're doing, that you're
supposed to do.
You get it if one of the managers sees you walking over to somebody doing something wrong, and you say, become a mentor and correct their bad work habits. And it is working really, really well.
Like a coaching.
Yes. And it's I can't say enough of how much it's worked for us. Year one that I was there, previous year, they had 48 OSHA recordables in 8 weeks with 15,000 man hours lost. That's just an 8-week processing. Last year we had one recordable with 200 hours lost. engaging the workers and getting them to buy into ownership of safety.
Yeah, and it is. The safety culture is when everybody around the city, and they accept it, they acknowledge it, they
general managers involved down to the level, coming to the meetings on a monthly basis, directly to the employees and talk directly to the board coordinator and ask them what's the problem and what kind of issue. Talk about general as a command, I would literally get out of my uniform, put in the civilians, and walk around and talk to soldiers until I get discovered. But they would tell me, they would say, yeah, this is a problem. And, you know, then, you know, the guy come out and call the unit to attention. Poor kid, like spot there. I said, no, you're fine. This is the only way I can fix the problem.
Right.
Exactly. You tell me what's wrong, because typically that commander or that boss, they can tell that boss that, oh, yeah, that's a problem. You know, that soldier's going to say, this is jacked up. What idiot thought of this?
We'll take care of the problem.
And that's the most of the time our employees are aligned. They'll really understand the hazard that's in place and understand the solution around it because they work on it on a daily basis.
Yes.
And I think sometimes we don't take that into account.
Don't listen.
We're dealing with our parents.
Yes.
Here's process and policy in the school we believe that should be done. And let's kind of trickle it down. Who's going, let's hear it from the line level employee.
It should be bottom-up. It should be just as much strength both ways.
You can't proceduralize it.
safety management system, they force that process to happen. Their management is engaged. You have to do reports typically. With the program, we just go in lines and just need to put that manual in.
Well, as Paul used to say,
and why does it take us so long as an industry to adapt to that extent?
You know, I wish I knew that. The answer to my question, because I don't.
Yeah,
because it works.
I mean, it's like almost step by step on how it's laid out in the process.
And it works. It's what we should be doing. And who do we ask? You said it earlier. Who knows the risk better than anybody else? The workers. Ask them. I was going to tell you. We have a home sprinkler system, and we have an outside room that's like skinny. And all it's got is fittings, plumbing, all the daily system of pump, basically. We're replacing everything. And so we have new employees, and we have our employees, which probably get their own opinion too. It's hard to believe. But yeah, they are. Our union employees, we have other from the Tessite union employees. And they're in there, and they had a tough time. I was here yesterday morning, so I didn't see any of this, but they had a tough time taking out some of these heavy fittings. I mean, it was difficult. We talked about it. We had to work with them out there. We had some things in place for them. Unfortunately, it wouldn't fit into this tight, cramped quarters, and the doors were at the other end. So they tried, I guess, with it yesterday, and had time, part-time, to be off and out and down, and it was heavy. So today, I'm sitting here and I'm staring at them because I wasn't there yesterday, so I have to make up for it. So I'm in the building now, just in my eye, watching them. They're watching me and I'm watching them. They're thinking, you know, it's heavy. Yeah, I was thinking, how did you do it yesterday? It was hard. I said, what are you going to do today? And that's all I said. What are you going to do today? I was, I'm willing to help, but I was having an issue trying to figure out how to help too. All right? It was pretty tight. So they got a ladder. They got a ladder the same height. And they actually, after they had screwed it, they just stood right over the ladder. And then they just kind of lowered the ladder down. And I'm thinking, well, this is working. There was nothing else that would affect me. And I'm like, oh, this is kind of working. Supposed to be going that way, but it's working. They got it all the way down. They all, three of them, scooted over to the thing. We had a forklift running at that point into the doorway. Now it's at the doorway, and they can actually lift it up in the doorway. But they thought of that themselves. I was just watching.
Necessity of the mother convention.
And they thought of it. And then today I asked just before I left, because they're getting closer to the door, I said, what are you going to do now? And they said, we can actually bring the forklift in, the time's close up, put the mask in, bring it over, and the next one we can actually put to support it and then take it out. So that was kind of cool. But, so they don't want to hurt themselves. They want to do it the right way. Sometimes things are difficult. You know? And if there was something I could have thought of to help him, I would have, but I was completely lost myself. So it was like, well, can't we get something in? And they looked at me and they went, how big is it? Eh, it won't fit. Okay, so anticipate what the risk is. Observe the work area. I'm just going over. And we have situational awareness. Have everybody, your observer program where people are watching each other, that's an observation program. That's a situational awareness. If they see somebody doing something at risk, they can stop. Okay? And they can stop. Actually, you want to take care of each other. And all of this involves very strong communication. You know, not afraid to report. Have you ever heard, why would I ever say that to them? They don't do anything bad. Because by the way, if you add that environment, it takes a long time to break down that barrier. It is not done overnight. When Ed started the Lyme Control Safety and Health Program, we figured it would be 5 years before it was instilled plant-wide. And I don't think we got all the way, but the ones that got it, they got it. Even though that program left, when the company changes, you know that works, it changes. The people, the individual groups,
Reportable injury and rate, I mean, within the first 6-7 months, about 30-40%. The management, you got to remember, people resent change. They're going to fight you tooth and nail. Well, we've always done it this way. And then once they start seeing it working, the management bought into it, and the union was the biggest support we had.
And actually, the union started training their employees in a lot of ways. Because they talked about it in the meetings. And they talked about their safety.
And they started policing themselves within their own group and say, stop. We have a program with checked in. You know, are you ready to do this? Are you ready to go? Communicate with one another. And it was a simple start. But like Joe was saying, what happened was, you can have a change at the top, changing the company, changing your process. But if you have a safety value, not a priority, safety value amongst the people, they will help each other. Now we have some of those, but just to pick somebody off the lat, you know, that's going to come in any organization. They just don't get along. You got to identify, modify, diversify, and get those people out of that arena area. But that is just a matter of thought, observation, and dedication to yourself and your people. But you're not cops. You're not cops. We're not OSHA. We should be technical advisors and be there and let them learn. Let them bring it up. And Joe did a wonderful job in a lot of those areas to say, gee, how would you fix it?
Why? Because we care about the people that work for us. they may not get, some of the senior managers may be fearful because they don't know what's going on. And they're not sure they're being told the right thing. So you gotta think it from their point of view too, if they're walking into brand spanking. That, oh, that's the way I learned how to communicate. Was that thought process. Because I started putting myself in their shoes. And I thought, because what Buzz told me, that stuck in my mind, he goes, well, you never tell the middle managers to tell you the whole truth and all, everything but the truth. And he said that one day to me, and I said, why? He said, because I just want to come and talk to you. And I said, well, you know, for a long time, I didn't know who you were. But I started putting myself in their shoes, and you know what? They were only seeing one perspective. One, they got a whole big picture. Right? They got a whole kit of people. And they're responsible for everybody in that company. So start putting, I just started putting myself in their shoes, and then I started communicating better. It did work. Because once you put yourself in somebody else's shoes,
he never gave up, Joe. He never gave up.
So, anyway. So communication, I'm running here. So not afraid to report. Communication at all levels. Safety concern, put that in place. And know as a safety leader, you need to have that available. And you need to have that open door philosophy as a safety leader. That they can come walk in at any point in time and you'll stop and talk to them. My people know that, that's the crazy, but they know that I will. When they walk in, everything I'm working on moves back, and I say, what's that? What's going on? How can I help? The way to communicate. People like that. Treat them with respect. They like the whole world. Treat them that they matter, and they do. We all matter. Okay. So what do you have in place? And what I'd like to see is, when I'm asking you these questions, I'm hoping that you're asking yourselves these questions. Because that's how I learn. Like, when they were doing the active shooting yesterday, I was sitting thinking, I kept looking at, you know, Jimmy going, we have that? You know, that's what we're doing. Do we have things in place now? Are we able to react quickly? Ask yourself, as I'm a safety leader, what do I need? I know we get busy. So, what do we have in place to communicate? Okay. I kind of said this in the beginning. I'm going to just wrap it up because it's late in the day. Anybody want to stand up and stretch?
That was next door.
I thought that was first.
No, second. All right. Transition change, time change, companies change, people change. People grow, companies grow. You know, when we started at Rocky Flats, we had 14,000 people. That's a lot of people. I find that working in an organization, like we're off from the rest of the organizations, every organization is different from your department. If you're working in a department, an organization, work people. It's hard to work a whole company, but if you do, work it, if you have a small number of people, work it. Does that make sense? You know. So during this time of change, tune up your skills, be situational awareness. Biggest thing, the accidents we're seeing right now that's going on with our company right now are people are not focused on what the job is. They're not focused on the task. And a lot of times it's not even work that they're getting hurt at. It's walking in the parking lot and falling down in the parking lot. Or falling over something. Or just, it's crazy right now. People are focused. And I don't think that's just our company. It's our world right now. So situational awareness, get people in line, keep them focused. And be in the moment, live in the present.